You are listening to the Mark Guzman Podcast Experience.
Now, how do you find these animals, excuse me, that are injured? I mean, do people report them to you? Do you have, patrolies that are up and down on the beaches? And if someone comes across, for example, an injured sea lion, what should they do?
So if someone comes across an injured sea lion, I always harp to have our hotline either ready to go or memorized. And it's a very easy number to memorize. So it's 415-289-SEAL, which is 7325. But the main things, or there are three main things. Number one is to have that hotline ready to go. Number two is to keep your distance. We know that it's human nature to want to intervene and help something that's injured or looks sick or helpless, and that's awesome, and that's what we want. But at the same time, these are wild animals, and in order for human safety as well as their safety, we do always recommend to keep your distance, and your pets too. So keep your distance, have that hotline, give us a call, and let us know. So take the best notes you can, and all the way down from, does it have ears, and what's the color, and what's it doing? Is it sleeping? Is it awake? Is the head up? Are the eyes open to anything significant that they see? Is there a large injury? Is it bleeding? Tell us exactly what you think's going on, and we really, really rely on the public to be our eyes and ears out there. That's where we get all of our calls from, and that's how we know that there's something out there that needs our help. So we truly appreciate it, and we always really, really appreciate these phone calls that we get, and that's what we rely on. Like I said, the public are our eyes and ears.
Are there any times where you rescue an animal that's injured and then the decision is to not release them into the wild and maybe put them into like a rescue center?
Normally, our main goal is obviously rescue and then rehabilitation. But as a veterinarian, it is my job, and I took an oath to make sure to do things that are in the best mindset and condition for that animal. So the animal's welfare is my number one concern. So with that being said, I want to release this animal back into the wild where it came from. However, if that means that I'm releasing it into a potential environment where it's not safe and it has a very poor chance of survival, then sometimes we do have to make a decision of whether or not it's appropriate to release this animal. And sometimes that decision is actually always that decision is not taken lightly, and it's a very difficult decision because some of the happiest days are when we can go out onto those releases. But there are times when we can't do that, and if that means that the animal gets to be placed in a facility where it gets round-the-clock care and veterinary care and food and is enjoying itself, then sometimes we do have to make that decision. And other times that decision also involves humane euthanasia, which is a very big part of veterinary medicine in general, because that oath that I took says that I am considering all animal welfare. And I'm doing no harm. And sometimes we have to take a quick step back and say, I want to treat this animal really bad, but is it better for the animal if I don't and actually end its suffering and pain? Or do I really think that this animal can be released, and am I really helping it, or am I just trying to do the human thing and do everything that I can? And so those decisions are always difficult, but there are times, although very few and far between, thankfully, there are times when we do have to make those decisions.
Mm-hmm. Now, if you decide to release, most of the animals are released back, what does that process look like? Are there regulations and red tape that you have to handle first before releasing an animal back?
From the veterinary side of things, our main concern is whether or not that animal will survive if released. So my main goal is to diagnose an animal when it comes through the door and treat it appropriately, get it, and then determine whether or not that disease or injury or whatever caused it to strand in the first place has been appropriately treated and resolved in order for him or her to be successful out in the wild. As far as red tape is concerned, there are not many rules and regulations that I have to go through, except for my own personal rules and regulations, and that's, again, to make sure that that animal will be successful in the wild. So there are release exams that we do as veterinarians to do a full physical exam, blood work, imagings, which are x-rays, ultrasounds, anything that we can gain from that animal as far as information to determine what the health status is of that animal, we do at that release exam. And then we look at all of the progress that animal has made since it's been here and determine whether or not they are okay to release. And again, that means whether or not they will be successful in the wild once they are released. And then our release sites are very important as well, because we always want to give the animals the best chance that they have once they get back out into the wild. So one of our favorite spots is up in Point Reyes. That's actually a peninsula that I think the peninsula that sticks out furthest into the Pacific Ocean and gives them the best chance to get out to that continental shelf where they can forage and where a lot of their food source is. And so we want to get them as close as we can to that area so they can acclimate back into the wild, learn to catch food on their own, and realize that, oh, my food's not going to be thrown at me anymore, and it's a lot more difficult to find it in this much larger pool than it was where I was before. And so we always want to give them the best chance that they can once they are released.
Okay. And then do you tag the animals and keep track of them for like science and future reference?
So tagging, there are multiple different tags. Every single animal that comes through our door gets a flipper tag, which is basically just a little piece of jewelry. And that helps other rescue centers across the coast know if this animal has been in rehab, and it also helps with resites. So there are tourists and locals and fishermen and all kinds of people going out on boats every single day, and we want to know if they see an orange tag on a flipper of an animal, and we want to know everything about it. We want to know if that animal looks good, is with its a group of its peers, and we want to know as much information. So that little piece of jewelry really helps us determine how that animal is doing once it's released. The more expensive tags, which are satellite tags, we would love to put them on every single animal that came through our door, but they are quite expensive. And what we usually use those for are for our endangered species. So we do get some listed or endangered species that come to the center that we rehabilitate, most specifically the Guadalupe fur seals. And not a lot of information is known about them. They are all the way out from Guadalupe Island. They're these fur seals that forage in the really deep ocean. We call that the pelagic foraging. So we don't get a lot of information from them. So if we happen to get one of those and they are stable enough to be released, we will put satellite tags on them. And we have gained so much information about where they forage, where they hang out, where their rookeries are, what their basically their life history is. And so with that information, we can better treat them if and when they do come to us in the center. We can better monitor their progress and hopefully encourage more of a recovery of that species. So those are the types of tags that we'll put on. There are some special cases where if we have an animal that has a really specific disease that we haven't seen before, we don't have a lot of information, and we can gain information on future animals that strand by putting a satellite tag on them, we've used a satellite tag for those situations, but most of the time we use it to help with our species survival, and the Guadalupe fur seals are one of the main examples of those right now for us.
Okay. What are some of the more unique animals that you've seen come come across the center?
Rotating back to the Guadalupe fur seals, I think those are.
Thank you for listening to this podcast short. For more podcast content, be sure to subscribe to all of our podcast channels on YouTube, iTunes, iHeartRadio, Spotify, Libsyn, Castbox, Podbean, and literally anywhere else you listen to podcasts.